As the title suggests, we're interested in PDEs such as those appearing in the box. And in particular, we are after this function v that depends on both space and time, so x and t. In applications, v might often be the value function in an optimal control problem, or the option price in finance, or it might represent the particle density in a certain physical system. The PDEs under consideration consist of two parts. First, there is the diffusion part, modeling diffusive behavior, and then there is the nonlinearity H, typically associated with interaction. Finally, the PDE is augmented with a final. First of all, we are often faced with a curse of dimensionality, that is, with a high dimensional, with a high dimensionality of the variable x on which v depends. And then there's the nonlinearity H, which often leads to highly non-trivial complex dynamics, which is really difficult to reason about and also hard to resolve numerically. Our approach rests on two pillars. First of all, we level regression type reformulations of the PDEs in question in terms of backward SDEs, so BSDEs for short. And secondly, we decompose the function V using tensors in order to identify low dimensional structures, which are really typical of PDEs coming from applications. The main finding of our paper is that these two sets of tools really interact very nicely. In fact, in some of our experiments, we even observe a blessing of dimensionality. That is, using the methods developed in this paper, it might in fact be easier to solve a high dimensional than a low dimensional PDE. This slide is about the first pillar, so about the stochastic representations of PDEs in terms of backward SDEs. As a motivation, start with the left-hand side of the figure, showing the usual equidistant grid on which the solution could, for instance, be obtained using a standard finite difference scheme. Now, the problem with this approach is that the number of grid points required for a certain accuracy will scale exponentially with the dimensionality. Coming to the right-hand side, we see a random grid associated to the diffusion process X defined below. And the motivation for using such a random grid is that it holds the promise of at least slightly alleviating the curse of dimensionality using ideas from Monte Carlo. Now, in order to solve the PDE, we define the processes Y and Z, essentially representing the solution and its gradient along the random grid X. Using Itu's formula, we then obtain the backward SDE, backward stochastic differential equation for Y, which is called backward because it has a terminal condition. Summing up the result or the content of the slide, we can think of this backward SDE as a stochastic substitute for the usual finite difference approximation of a differential operator.
So in order to get an implementable algorithm, we need to discretize our stochastic processes, which we do on a time grid from 0 to capital T, on n plus 1 grid points, where we essentially use this Euler-Maruyama scheme, where this xi is a standard normally distributed random variable that corresponds to the Brownian motion term. The BSDE can be discretized in two ways, depending on whether we actually choose the right or the left endpoint of this nonlinear function h. In the first line, you can see the right endpoint, dotted with this n plus 1 here. And on the second line, you can see the left endpoint. Importantly, in both ways, we have the terminal condition to be g of xn. And so this actually motivates, since the terminal condition is known, to solve this BSDE also backwards in time. So let us illustrate this in a schematic version on this slide here. And first recall that our backward process yn is supposed to be equal to the PDE solution v at time tn. So the idea is to find a parametric ansatz for these yn's, which we denote with vn hat. And then, as mentioned before, we want to solve backwards in time. But first, we simulate our data points, the x forward process, from 0 to capital N. So these are n plus 1 data vectors which are available. Then we start our backwards machinery. And as I mentioned before, we know that at capital N, our true solution is equal to G. So we initialize it with that. And then we do one time step backwards to get Vn minus one. Then we do another time step backwards to get Vn minus two, and so on. So we iterate this process to eventually end up at V0, such as x hat. So I didn't tell you yet how actually we do these steps and these red arrows. So this I will tell you now. And for this, we have actually two schemes available, an explicit and an implicit scheme. And they come from these two ways of discretizing the backwards process. So I wrote them down again here. So we have seen this before. And these two ways differ in whether I take this hn plus one or hn, which I highlighted in red here. And still the question remains how we actually can solve for the yn plus one terms. And it turns out that they both can be written down as a minimization task, where we minimize with respect to this function vn hat. And I wrote down the two objectives here. On the left-hand side, you can see it for the explicit scheme. And the right-hand side looks a little bit more complicated, and I highlighted again the differences in red. Essentially, we see that instead of this hn plus one, we have this h hat n, which crucially now depends on the quantity with respect to which we want to minimize, this vn hat. And also we have additionally this psi n plus one term here. So the right-hand side looks a little bit more complicated. And the essential difference is that the left-hand side, of course, depending on an appropriate ansatz function class, can often be seen as a linear regression, which usually can be solved in closed form. The implicit scheme, on the other hand, corresponds to a nonlinear regression, for which you need iterative solvers, which might be a little bit more complicated. And so far, we haven't talked about how we actually approximate these V hat n's. So we didn't talk about function classes yet. In the last years, people have often taken neural networks, but now we propose to rely on tensor trains. And next, Leon will tell us about these function classes.
In the next step, we choose a function class and briefly show how to find an optimal representative within this class. We use the set of tensor trains, and I'm going to explain what this set is. We start by choosing one-dimensional ansatz functions mapping from R to R. For example, one-dimensional polynomials, finite elements, or a combination of both. In the case of polynomials, m is the maximum degree minus one. In order to represent a d-dimensional function, we take the tensor product of those, and the coefficients are given by a d-dimensional coefficient tensor. We call this an order d tensor. This tensor, denoted by C, suffers from the curse of dimensionality, which means that the number of coefficients increases exponentially with the dimension d. We introduce a contraction between the first and the last index of two tensors. As you can see in the sum, two order three tensors, W1 and W2, are contracted, and an order four tensor remains. We can represent any order D tensor by D minus one of these contractions and D tensors U1 to UD. Note that U1 and UD are order two tensors, which means that they are matrices and the others are order three. The important number in this representation is the rank R, which appears in the component tensors. Assuming moderate R, the exponential number of coefficients gets reduced to m times R squared times d, which means linear increase with respect to d. This parametrization is also known in the physics community as matrix product states. We say that C is a tensor and the combination of U1 to UD with any contraction is a tensor network. These tensor networks are oftentimes represented using graphs. Nodes are component tensors and vertices between them are contractions. The four vertices without any connection show that the tensor network represents an order four tensor. Returning to the representation of functions, we have to sum all the one-dimensional functions together with the coefficient tensor. This is done by introducing the mapping phi, taking a one-dimensional x and stacking the one-dimensional functions phi I into a vector. Contracting phi of x I with the tensor train then yields a mapping from Rd to R as desired. We extend the ansatz space by adding the final condition. This is also done in computational finance and also proposed for linear function spaces in the context of BSDEs. This procedure only increases the dimension of the ansatz space by one, and thus that does not increase the complexity of the computations in a relevant way. The remaining question is how to find optimal component tensors UI and CG. Note that due to the condition applied directly. However, there is an efficient algorithm, the alternating least squares algorithm, which reduces the high-dimensional problem to a sequence of low-dimensional subproblems. The important observation is that by fixing every core except for one, a low-dimensional linear parametrization is remaining. The ALS algorithm first optimizes U1, then goes from left to right and repeats this procedure until the last one is optimized. We use a rank adaptive extension of such an algorithm, and this is done, was done by Krasidik and Kremer. For the explicit problem, this can be applied directly. For the implicit version, we use an iterative scheme, which is given as below, and this reduces the nonlinear regression problem to a sequence of linear regression problems.
So finally, let us provide some numerical examples in order to illustrate the performance of our algorithm. We start with the Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman equation, which is a prominent PDE in control theory. Consider dimension D to be 100, and I wrote down the PDE here, so it contains this a plus term, which essentially has second derivatives, and a quadratic nonlinearity. I also wrote down the corresponding diffusion, which is a scale for any motion, and again, the nonlinear function h. We compare the tensor train format with the neural networks, which have four hidden layers, and also we contrast the implicit with the explicit scheme. The first line, you can see the approximated solution at time 0 and place x0. And for this, we have a reference value available. So we can compute the relative errors. And in the second line, you can see them, also realizing that the tensor trains are quite a bit better than the neural networks. Also, we compute what we call the PDE loss. So we evaluate along the trajectory of the forward process how much the PDE is actually fulfilled. And here you can also see that the tensor train version is quite a bit better than the neural network. Maybe also important is the computational time, where you can see that the tensor trains are significantly faster in this case. Here you can see again the approximated solution compared to the reference solution evaluated along trajectories of the forward process. On the left-hand side, you see the tensor train version, which almost fits the solution perfectly. And on the right-hand side, you see the neural networks, which are a little bit worse in this case. For this example, it was quite interesting for us to see some kind of blessing of dimensionality. So in some sense, actually, this problem gets easier if the dimension increases. So for the tensor trains, we saw that when looking at the polynomial degree needed for the ansatz functions in the tensor network. So here you can see that when we choose smaller dimensions for the problem, a higher polynomial degree was needed, whereas when we increased the dimension, then the polynomial degree was enough to be zero. So this means essentially constant ansatz functions, which surprised us quite a bit. And we think that in general, it might be interesting to investigate this phenomenon further. Another example is a little bit more complicated. It looks pretty similar. It's still in Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman PDE, but now instead of the Laplace, we have this diffusion operator L in here. And this L also contains the drift B, which in our case is the negative gradient of potential psi. The psi is written down here. So it essentially has this interaction between the dimensions because this matrix C here is non-diagonal. We consider the dimension 20 and have again this quadratic nonlinearity. We again compare tensor trains with neural networks, and here you can see that the relative error is pretty comparable, maybe a little bit better for the tensor trains, and also the PDE loss is quite a bit better for the implicit tensor train scheme. So in general, the implicit tensor trains seem to work best. And here you can see again that the computational time is much better for the tensor trains. So with this, I would like to thank you a lot for your attention. And please don't hesitate to ask any questions. Here are our email addresses. Thanks a lot. Have a nice day.